Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here, and I want to thank Professor Kim for inviting me to come to Waterloo. Waterloo, with its, you know, famous engineering department and its world-leading institute in quantum computation, is really known all over the world, and I always felt I have to come here and see the place in person. So I'm happy to give the public lecture today. And since this is a public lecture, let me ask you, who of you is not a physicist? Excellent. The lecture is for you. For the rest of you who is physicist, maybe it's a demonstration for you how you can try to explain physics to non-physicists. But, I try to pitch it simple, but I hope I have even a few things for the physicists which will make you think. So anyway, this is a public lecture about low temperature physics, and let me start very general in saying that to go to lower and lower temperature is really a recipe for discoveries and breakthrough. Whenever you go to lower temperature, you may find something which just doesn't exist at higher temperature. And if you look through the history of physics, when people liquefied for the first time liquid helium and reached the Kelvin scale, they discovered something completely unprecedented, superconductivity. It came as a big surprise, and Kamerling, honest, was awarded the Nobel Prize for that. People then reached mini-Kelvin physics using Pomeranchu cooling with helium-3, and they also made a discovery, a new form of superfluidity in helium-3, which was paradigmatic for physics and a lot about phase transitions and thermodynamics at low temperature was learned from that. And again, the people who made a discovery at milliKelvin received the Nobel Prize for it. Now, laser cooling was a whole new technique which allowed to use lasers to cool atoms down even closer to absolute zero, and people reached with these methods microKelvin temperatures and made a number of important studies and discoveries. And again, three of the people who invented the techniques to cool atoms to microKelvin temperatures were recognized with a Nobel Prize in physics. And finally, going down the temperature scale, when we developed techniques how to get down to nanoKelvin temperature, we made a new discovery, and I will tell you more about it, a very special new form of matter, the Bose-Einstein condensate, and this resulted in the Nobel Prize in 2001. So I mentioned already that low temperatures is a recipe for discovery because materials change their properties, and sometimes in a dramatic way. For instance, with this example here, if you live in a country which has a hot climate, you would never see ice, you would never experience snow unless you're an engineer or scientist and develop a refrigerator. So in some way, what I want to tell you today is we now have a nanoKelvin refrigerator, and I want to show you the snow, the new phases of matter, which only form at such low temperatures. This picture of frozen water is also illustrating something which is important for my talk, namely the concept of phase transition. If you cool down something, the properties may gradually change. Water is getting colder and colder, but then there is a sudden change, water becomes frozen. And those phase transitions are special in physics because there is something interesting going on. Matter is reorganizing itself, and often there are special new phases of matter, and I want to talk to you about some of them. So let me illustrate to you some low temperature, and let's get started with, you know, rather trivial things, but I want to warm you up or cool you down in going down the temperature scale. So let's get the technique going. So what I have in
What I have in this cup is liquid nitrogen. I will tell you a little bit more about it. It's something which is very, very cold. And, well, you're familiar with freezing water. Water you can just put in the freezer and you can study it at home. Do you know something which would not freeze in a freezer? Whiskey. So whiskey you could never put in a freezer and it would get frozen. It stays liquid. But thanks to my magic liquid nitrogen, I can now freeze it and you will see frozen whiskey. Well, when you give an experimental lecture, it's also a little exercise in patience. You know, if you want to make something real in the laboratory, it takes a while, and you have to be patient, but you should also have the confidence that ultimately it will work. Also, I'm sometimes getting a little bit nervous when I'm on stage and I want to demonstrate to you something. Okay. Yeah, so what you see here now, let me put it in the screen, it is frozen, it's frozen whiskey. Okay, you can't do that in your freezer, but you can do it with dry ice. Because dry ice, the domestic freezer goes to minus 20 centigrade, dry ice goes to minus 78 centigrade. So what liquid would not freeze even with dry ice? Any idea? So dry ice is at minus 78 degrees centigrade. Actually, with whiskey, we are getting close, yes? Some oils. I don't actually know what the freezing point of oil is, but maybe you want to now go home and look it up because I introduced you to some interesting questions. But whiskey is 40% alcohol. If you take pure alcohol has actually a freezing temperature of minus 100 degrees. Well, it depends. If you use methanol, it's minus 98. If you use propanol, it's minus 90. So I have methanol and isopropanol. Let's just use one of them. So I'm showing you now something which freezes at minus 100 degrees centigrade. You would not be able, definitely not in your freezer, and even dry ice would not cool it down, would not freeze it. Actually, I'm trying also to teach you a few things. Do you remember what is the temperature of dry ice? Minus 78. What is the typical temperature of your freezer at home? Minus 20. And this now, when it's frozen, it takes another 10 or 20 seconds, will be at minus 100 degrees. Okay, so what you see here now is pure alcohol frozen at a temperature of minus 100 degrees. Okay, I come back to the temperature scale, but since we are talking about properties of matter, I also wanted to show you that low temperature can sometimes provide you with some surprises. So we have seen the phenomenon of liquids which freeze. I want to show you now how something like a flower will also dramatically change its properties when I take it and freeze it down in liquid nitrogen. So the flower is now cooled. Liquid nitrogen is about minus 200 degrees centigrade, so another 100 degrees colder than the pure alcohol. And now I've frozen it down, and it has become completely brittle. It shatters like thin glass. Well, why don't we freeze something else, just for fun? So, I mean, this is... It's a real banana. And... So let's see what we can do with a banana, which is not just put into a freezer to minus 20 degrees. I put it in liquid nitrogen, which is minus 200 degrees. Banana is a chunk of material, so it will actually take a minute or so to cool down. So with a banana, you would usually, what you connect to it? Now, it's sweet, but it's also soft. What I want to show you now is that when I freeze the banana, it changes its properties so dramatically that I can use it as a hammer and hammer a nail into a piece of wood with a banana. Let's just check that, yeah, it's frozen enough. So I take the soft side of the banana. Oopsie. Maybe a little bit harder. Okay. So anyway, what you may have learned is if you want to put a nail into the wall and you don't have a hammer, but you have liquid nitrogen and a banana, you can still do it. Okay, let me go back to projection mode. So let's come back to low temperature. Let's just repeat. We talked about the domestic freezer. We talked about whiskey, which has a freezing point of minus 26. We talked about dry ice. We talked about pure alcohol, which requires minus 100. And now we go even deeper when we have liquefied gases. If you liquefy air, air consists of oxygen and nitrogen. And I've given you on this slide what is the temperature when oxygen and nitrogen liquefies. And the liquid I'm using here is liquid nitrogen, which is at minus 196 degrees centigrade. But that's not all of it. I mean, we've gone down to the boiling point of liquid nitrogen, but now I want to take you lower to very low temperatures to minus 273 degrees, which is the zero of the absolute temperature scale. And by the way, you all know that it's not possible to go lower than absolute zero. You cannot go lower than minus 273 degrees. And the answer is very simple. We define the absolute temperature scale that zero Kelvin means there is zero free energy left in the substance. So the mystery which there are people, when I reach nano-Kelvin temperature, they say, you've come so close. Can't you just push a little bit harder and go below zero? Absolutely not. Because at absolute zero, matter has lost all its available energy. And you cannot have less energy than no energy. And just the simple sentence, you cannot have less energy than no energy, that tells you that it's not possible to go below absolute zero, because physicists have defined the temperature scale in such a way that absolute zero temperature means there is no available energy left in any form of matter. That's the question. Okay. Are you a physicist? Anyway. This lecture is for the non-physicists, but let me give you a quick answer. Yes, in certain systems, spin systems, it is possible to go to infinite temperature and then put even more energy into the system. And this is now described by a system with negative temperature. But since you have to go to negative temperature by putting more energy into the system than at infinite temperature, it is actually correct to say that negative temperature is actually hotter than infinite temperature. So therefore, it doesn't contradict at all when I'm saying you cannot go below absolute zero. You have to now be very careful how you define with entropy, but let me not go further than saying you put more and more energy into a system. It heats up, it heats up. In normal systems, you can never reach infinite temperature because it would require infinite energy. But there are certain systems in nature which are bounded in the highest energy state. And then you can put more, then you do not need infinite energy for infinite temperature, and therefore you can put even more energy into the system than it is needed for infinite temperature. And then you have to introduce negative temperatures to characterize this form of matter. But this really shows you negative temperatures are inverted systems. They have population inversion, and they are hotter, more energetic than positive temperatures. So if we go down to temperature, absolute zero is the lowest temperature. Okay, so, yeah. So if you go, we've talked about liquid nitrogen, we talked about liquid oxygen. If you go down further, we liquefy helium, this is at 4 Kelvin. And 2.8 Kelvin is an important benchmark. That's the temperature of interstellar space. So after the Big Bang, the universe was expanding and cooling down, and after about 15 billion years, it has now reached the state where in interstellar space, we have a temperature of 2.8 Kelvin. So on a Kelvin scale, this is 100 times colder than room temperature, which is around 300 Kelvin. But today, I want to talk to you about temperatures which are not just 100 times colder than interstellar space, like liquid helium. We want to go down by another factor of a million and a billion in temperature scale. We want to talk about forms of matter at microkelvin or nanokelvin temperatures, just the billions of a degree above absolute zero. And so these nanokelvin atoms, which are now available in many laboratories around the world, I think without exaggeration, can be called the coldest matter in the universe. But it's not just cold matter, it's also matter which has very, very special properties. So anyway, let's go down in temperature and figure out what happens. Well, I think everybody knows, you almost learn that in kindergarten now, that when you reduce the temperature of an object, the motion slows down. And that means for a gas, in a gas at room temperature, the molecules move at the speed of sound, which is the speed of a jet airplane. But when we cool down to the temperatures we reach in our laboratory, then the velocity goes from a jet airplane to something which is as slow as my hand, millimeter per second. So this is extreme, this is cool, this is atoms in slow motion. And it's important to do very precise measurement on atoms. If they move very, very slowly, you can look at them much more closely. But it's just a gas where everything moves more slowly. What is special, and this is what I want to talk to you in a few minutes, is that at those low temperatures, there is also something special happening, which is a phase transition to a new form of matter. But before I do that, since this is an experimental lecture, I want to show you how molecules slow down at low temperature. So for the physicists, how would you demonstrate to somebody that molecules slow down at low temperature if you don't have a vacuum apparatus where you have at molecular beams and can measure the velocity? Excellent idea. You said you can hot, but the fact is now, let's talk about it. It's a good idea. But what you are overlooking is the slowdown is enormous on the absolute temperature scale. But if you talk about hot food, which is too hot to eat, and cold food, you're talking about a temperature range of maybe only 50 degrees. If something is 100 degrees, you burn yourself. But on an absolute scale, because everything energy is relative to absolute temperature, you're really talking about, in absolute temperature, something between 300 and 400 Kelvin. This is just 20%. So the velocity, the kinetic energy of hot molecules in this range, what we think is hot and what we think is cold, the energy or the absolute temperature differs only by 20%, and the velocity, which is the square root of kinetic energy, only differs by 10%. So maybe, but you have to now figure out if something is hot or cold, that it takes 10% faster or so. I don't think it's really the velocity of the molecules which makes a difference. Maybe there's one more suggestion? Thermal expansion and contraction. In some way, yes. If you have something, a piece of metal, and you cool it down, it contracts. It contracts literally because the atoms inside the metal are wiggling less. It's the wiggling motion which causes thermal expansion. I have another suggestion, which is actually fairly easy to show, and it's that. I have to use one equation, an equation for the ideal gas. If I have a balloon with air in it, you really see it has pressure. And the equation of the ideal gas for pressure is density times kinetic energy. So if I take this balloon and I cool it down with liquid nitrogen, you will see that it will shrink. So what I'm showing to you is that the pressure in the balloon goes down. And yeah, I cannot show you the velocity directly, but if you believe the simple formula that pressure is density times kinetic energy, what I'm showing you is that lower pressure means lower kinetic energy, and that means lower velocity. And if it warms up, it's back to the same pressure. So in some way you're seeing now that the velocity of the gas, the molecules get faster and faster, and this is building up the pressure again in the balloon. Okay, so what I said, the special thing about research in low temperature is not to make things slow down. The special aspect of low temperature research is you make discoveries of new form of matter. And so what we discovered is when a gas is cooled down, suddenly at nanokelvin temperature, the atoms are not just moving more and more slowly, the atoms are starting to march in lockstep. And this is shown here in this cartoon. So each guy here is an atom or molecule, and at high temperature or in the normal phase of matter, the guys are just running around, you know, like air molecules which randomly move around. But at low temperature, there is a phase transition to a new form of matter as sudden as water freezes at 0 degrees, and now all these atoms or molecules march in lockstep. And marching in lockstep is an organized, new organized form of matter. And marching in lockstep means also that these atoms are now superfluid. They share some properties with superconductors, and we will talk about it in a few minutes. But if you wonder what does it mean, marching in lockstep, well, it means that we now need a little bit of quantum mechanics, that these atoms are particles, but they also have wave character, and that means they all behave like one wave. So they are one wave, and they participate in this synchronized motion of a single wave. So this is what makes the Bose-Einstein condensate so special, and it is the discovery of Bose-Einstein condensation which was recognized with the 2001 Nobel Prize. But for the maybe non-physicist, I should try to give you another analogy. And this is the analogy with laser light. You all know about the fundamental difference between the light of a light bulb and the light coming out of a laser. In a light bulb, light is in many, many modes, goes in many, many directions, sort of randomly. But in the laser, all the photons are organized into one wave. They literally march together in one direction. And so what I just described to you as the difference between laser light and ordinary light, you can use exactly the same words to distinguish the Bose-Einstein condensate from an ordinary gas. So therefore, if you ask me to describe to you in one sentence, it's actually pretty hard, but in one sentence, what was the discovery which led to the Nobel Prize in 2001, I would say we created atoms with the properties of laser light. We created a form of matter which is for matter what the laser is for light. Okay, how do we get down to such low temperatures? Well, I could give you a whole lecture about the laser cooling, the evaporative cooling, and all the methods we are using. But what I think I should do instead, because it would take too much time, I should show you a few photos that you see how does it look like, and then I give you a cartoon drawing which summarizes it. So what you see here is one of the laboratories. Actually, this is the machine where we created one of the very first Bose-Einstein condensate. It's a vacuum machine. It has a tangle of cables for currents and magnets, but all the action takes place in this vacuum chamber. And it's surrounded with lots and lots of optics because this form of matter, we cannot touch it. It's too cold. We can only look at it with laser light. And the most important part of any such research are the young people, the students. This machine is built and operated mainly by graduate students, and here you see two of them in action. So this is sort of a close-up of another experiment in my group. Again, you see a vacuum chamber. This is a vacuum viewport. It has about a diameter of 7-8 centimeters, and it is right behind this viewport. This is where the very cold atoms, the nanokelvin atoms, are, and this is where we observe it. So we look through this window, we shine laser beams in it, and this is how we see what happens. I mentioned we use a lot of laser light, so this is a nice laser light show. Some lasers are invisible, too bad, but here we have an experiment where we use three visible lasers, yellow, red, and green. And it's a spectacular view, and each laser, each color, has a special function in the experiment. And eventually, here you see laser cooling in action. This is a vacuum chamber, and we use sodium. You know, sodium is what is inside those yellow street lights. That's a light of sodium. It's the same yellow, but here we have sodium vapor. We put laser beams into the chamber. We cool down. I'm not telling you how, but with the lasers, we cool down the sodium. And here you see this fuzzy spot a few millimeter in diameter. This is a cloud of sodium atoms cooled 1,000 times colder than interstellar space. But then we have to take it even to lower temperatures to observe Bose-Einstein condensation. So let me not dwell on the cooling techniques. I've shown you the vacuum chamber, and now here is the cartoon version. We have a vacuum chamber which isolates the cold atoms from the rest of the world. The cold atoms are held together. We cannot touch it. There's no material which we can bring in contact with them. They are held together by electric and magnetic fields. So if you want, you can imagine here is a vacuum chamber, and we pack magnets around it. And the magnets create magnetic walls. And between these magnetic walls, this is where the cold atoms are, and this is where we do our experiments. So magnetic walls means atoms which have an unpaired electron are a little bit magnetic. And you can imagine that if I'm an atom, I'm a little bit magnetic, like a compass needle. I try to go this way, but there's a magnetic field repelling me. I try to go the other way, there's a magnetic field sending me back. So this is sort of the invisible box. This is our magnetic container, which confines the atoms. Well, the question is now, how can we observe it? We cannot touch them. But one way how we can actually observe what is going on, and now we can really measure the velocity of the atoms, is we switch off our box. It's just magnetic fields. We can switch them off. And now if there is a teeny little motion left in the cloud will expand. And we can now shine a laser beam on it, the atoms scatter light, and with a digital camera, we collect the shadow of the atoms. So what do we learn from the shadow? We learn how fast the atoms are, because originally they were very small, then we let them go, and after a little while, we take the shadow picture. So the size of the cloud is simply the velocity times the time we allowed the atoms to expand. And so this is one of my most complicated formulae in this lecture. If you know the velocity by just looking how fast the cloud expands, you know the kinetic energy. But then you know the absolute temperature, absolutely, without any ambiguity, without any need to calibrate. So this is how we cool down. This is how we know we are at microkelvin, we are at nanokelvin. So, and now I want to show you how we observe the Bose-Einstein condensate. So the picture is we cool down the atoms, we let them expand and take a picture. And we cool them down by blowing at them with radio waves. I'm not trying to explain it to you. So the atoms expand, we take this picture. And those atoms are eventually pumped out of our vacuum chamber. But now, 10 or 20 or 30 seconds later, we have the next bunch of atoms. And this time, we set our refrigerator to a little bit lower temperature. How will the shadow of the cloud look like when the cloud is now a little bit colder? A little bit smaller. Because colder means lower velocity, and that means the cloud will not expand so much. So what I want to show you now is a series of pictures. Each was taken at successively lower temperature, and we are already very cold. So you see how the cloud in each step is shrinking. We are getting even colder. But now when the cloud shrinks, something happens. Something forms inside. It looks like a cherry with a pit. There is a bimodal distribution. There is originally the round cloud, and then something sharper, elliptical, forms inside. I will play it for you again. But this elliptical part, these are the blue guys which march in lockstep. This is the Bose-Einstein condensate. And the round part, this was the normal atoms which randomly move. So let me first show it to you again and then explain it to you a little bit further. This was actually how we discovered the Bose-Einstein condensate. We cooled down the cloud and just observed what happened to those shadow pictures. And about now, there is a sudden phase transition where this ellipse forms. So let me explain to you what you have seen. The first thing you saw, the cloud was shrinking. That meant it's getting colder and colder. But then something formed inside, which was even smaller. That meant it had pretty much no velocity, or almost no velocity at all. So this inner part must be ice cold. Well, everything is ice cold here, but even colder. And this is the Bose-Einstein condensate. But the other, even more striking feature was, initially at the initial temperature, the cloud was perfectly round. And let me now, but then what formed inside this inner shadow was elliptical. So the reason is the following. If you look through the equations for magnetic fields, it is much, much easier to build a magnetic box which is elongated and not round. But if you are at a normal temperature and have a normal gas, particles move randomly in all directions, or to say it this way, the velocity distribution is isotropic. So therefore, if we switch off the magnetic walls, the gas expands in all directions, and we see a shadow which is almost perfectly round. But when the Bose-Einstein condensate forms, there is no randomness. It's pretty much, it's a wave. And if the container is elliptical, which it is, then the wave is elliptical, and this is what you saw. So in other words, you saw to some extent that there was a sudden change in properties from round to elliptical, but the sudden change is indicative that a phase transition to a different form of matter has taken place. Okay, let me come back to this picture, particles marching in lockstep, particles just forming one wave. This is actually even more special than just being cold. And let me now show you how we were able to observe that the atoms march in lockstep. Okay, marching in lockstep, I have to translate, means they are single coherent wave. And let me remind you how we observe wave properties in nature. Let me first contrast it with the example of something which doesn't have wave properties, or at least not, I mean, everything has wave properties, everything is quantum mechanical, but something which doesn't show wave properties in a prominent form, and this is red paint. If I have a paint ball, throw it on a white wall, I get a spot of red paint, and if you take a second one, and the two red patches of paint overlap, what you see is something really simple. Red paint and red paint gives darker red paint. But now replace the paint with red laser beams. Take one red laser beam, but now you take a second one, and then you observe an interference pattern. You observe where the two waves come together that you have something different. You have actually now the possibility that light and light can give darkness because the positive electric field of the electromagnetic wave, which describes light, and the negative electric field can add up to zero. So the feature of interference shows that it's a wave, and if this pattern is very regular, it also shows that it is just one wave, one mode, that it is coherent. So you get the idea. Two paintballs, two laser beams, we need two Bose-Einstein condensates. And well, this is sort of a picture taken by light scattering, which shows this elongated Bose-Einstein condensate. And since we needed two to look for the interference, we literally took a Bose-Einstein condensate and using a green laser beam, which acted as a knife, we were cutting the Bose-Einstein condensate into two pieces. So now we have the situation that we have two Bose-Einstein condensates, we switch off everything and they fall down. Yeah, that's what everything does. But the condensates, because the atoms repel each other a little bit, also expand into each other. And now the question is, do they behave like paint particles or do they behave like laser light? So we take a shadow picture, and what we observed was this interference pattern. It looks like a zebra. So out here, this is only light, but it looks a little bit noisy. We cannot use a lot of light, otherwise we would heat up the condensate too much. But here you see the shadow, but the shadow has a modulation. There is darkness, that's where the light is absorbed because there are atoms, but then between the dark fringes, there is light. And there can only be light if there are no atoms which absorb the light or scatter the light. So in other words, and you see the perfect straightness of the fringes. So this really showed that Bose-Einstein condensate have the same property as laser light. And what you also see here, let me express it in that way. Remember, paint and paint gives darker paint. Light and light, depending on the relative phase, can give bright light or darkness. And what you see here, where the light comes through, there is no shadow, there is no atoms. So atoms and atoms can add up to nothing, to vacuum, exactly, and that's exactly the same thing as light. Because the positive wave function and the negative wave function, which describes atoms, can add up to zero. So this was dramatically demonstrated here. Okay, this is an experimental lecture, and I'm trying to show to you the properties related to our research. We had a I hope impressive demonstration, well, joking, how molecules slow down. And now I would like to show you how particles march in lockstep. Of course, I cannot bring a big laboratory here and demonstrate that to you, but I can use something which comes very, very close and shows you the principle. And this is, I want to use superconductors. I said that the essence of the Bose-Einstein condensate is they march in lockstep, and that turns the gas into a superfluid. And this is very analogous to what happens in certain materials when we cool them down and they become superconducting. Superconductivity can be described by electrons or electron pairs which march in lockstep. So let's just assume we had electrons marching in lockstep, and I want to show you that those electrons march in lockstep. How can I show it to you? Well, I don't have a microscope to show you the electrons, but I can show you the consequence of it. When electrons march in lockstep, then they can create, because they all march in the same direction, they can create a current, which is a supercurrent, a current which flows without dissipation. There is no power supply and no battery. And I can show you that there is a current because the current creates a magnetic field. So this is what I want to show you. I brought some superconductors. I want to cool them down in liquid nitrogen. And then I want to show you that below a certain temperature, there's a phase transition, that suddenly the electrons march in lockstep, and we can observe the magnetic field which is generated by those electrons. Any questions? So I want to show you electrons march in lockstep in full analogy to the Bose-Einstein condensate, and we observe this motion of many electrons in lockstep through the fact that they create a magnetic field. In order to explain it to you, let me start with something simpler first, and then I build it up from there. There are many, many electrons in copper. And if I have a magnet, I can make the electron, this is Faraday's law of induction. If I move magnets close to the electrons, through Faraday's laws of induction, I create a current, and this current creates a magnetic field. So what I want to show to you in the following way. I have this copper piece, and I want to create a magnetic field with a magnet. But those two objects look the same, but one is a magnet and one not. And you will see a dramatic difference. So if I take the piece which is not magnetic and drop it through this copper tube, it just falls through. So it just falls through, and this is what normal objects do. It's not magnetic, so the copper is just a guide. But now I use a strong magnet and drop it through. This magnet will create current, which creates an electric field. This is called eddy current. So I just drop it through. It takes almost forever. So this shows you how, if I move a magnet in a conductor, it moves very, very slowly. The objects are the same. There is no difference in friction. The difference really comes that the moving magnet creates eddy currents, which create a magnetic field, which slows down the fall of the magnet. Why am I explaining that to you? I thought I wanted to talk about superconductors. Well, so what I showed you is if a magnet drops through a piece of copper, the copper creates a current, and this is an eddy current, and it slows down the magnet. But now, yeah, exactly, this is what you saw. But let's now replace the copper by a superconductor. Now, in copper, normal metal, the current just decays. It dies out, Ohm's law, dissipation, and therefore the magnet can get through. But if it's a superconductor and I want to throw down a magnet, it will create an eddy current which will last forever because the electrons are marching in lockstep and they are not slowing down. It's a persistent superconducting current. So what I want to show you now is exactly that by using superconductors. So let me just prepare the demonstration. Well, let me first show you what I want to demonstrate to you. So I cool down a superconducting disk, which is, I show you it in a moment, and somewhat when I cool it down with liquid nitrogen, it goes through a phase transition, and at the phase transition, electrons march in lockstep. And that means because they march in lockstep, there is no friction between them, and they can perform, they can sustain a supercurrent which is persistent. And therefore, if I drop a magnet, the supercurrent will not decay, and the magnet will float. Let me switch to camera mode. Here we go. I need liquid nitrogen for that. Which we get. So this one here, it's a black disc. This black disc is ceramic. And this is a ceramic high-temperature superconductor. And now I pour some liquid nitrogen in it. Now we have to wait until the high-TC superconductor goes through the phase transition. And what I have here is a small magnet. And let's give it a try. If this black copper disc is now superconducting and allows electrons to march in lockstep, this magnet, when I lower it, exactly the same way how I threw a magnet through the copper, I lower it. And it should, if it had worked, levitate. Okay, it works. Yes. I will actually want to show you now, maybe many of you have seen it, but I want to show you now a series of superconducting levitation demonstrations, and step by step it gets more interesting. Because what I just showed to you here, I just want to make sure I can prepare the next demonstration. What I'm showing to you here is, in a way, very simple to explain. Because what I showed you can actually be explained by like a piece of copper, but the copper has no resistance. But superconductor is more than just the absence of resistance. So in other words, what I explained to you could be explained by Faraday's law of induction, which is what creates the eddy current, and the fact that there is no dissipation, that the resistance of the superconductor is zero. But now I want to show you something else, which is actually much more special and shows you how special superconductors is. And this is the following. I will now, in the next demonstration, not move the magnet down and create, so to speak, the eddy current. I will just put the magnet on the disk. There is no moving magnet, therefore there is no Faraday's law of induction which creates currents. So I have the superconducting disk, I have the magnet on top of it, and then I put liquid nitrogen on it. And if it were just Faraday's law of induction, there is nothing moving, so nothing would happen. But what I hope I succeed in showing to you is that suddenly the magnet is lifting off. Because the superconductor is not just an object which has zero resistance, it's a phase of matter which is purely diamagnetic, which is perfectly diamagnetic, and it wants to repel the magnetic field, and it can only do that by creating an anti-magnetic field, anti to the magnet which sits on top of it, and this lifts off the magnet. So let's see if we can make this work. Let's get rid of the liquid nitrogen. Let's take our superconducting disk and now let me take this silvery magnet and put it on top of it. So yeah, you see the black disk, you see the magnet on top of it. And if it were just Faraday's law of induction, nothing should happen. And now we cool down the superconductor. And let's see if something happens at the phase transition to the superconducting state. So you can observe electrons which march in lockstep literally with the naked eye. Okay, but so let me go back to presentation mode. Okay, so we have just seen that. So I explained it to you. This means at the phase transition, there is a dramatic change of the magnetic properties of the superconductor. It becomes fully diamagnetic and therefore has to expel all magnetic fields. And this is called the Meissner effect. If you follow them and have a little, and you would understand that this is a magnetic field expulsion and it should be purely repulsive. It repels. And that's correct. This Meissner effect, this diamagnetism, creates a repulsive force, and the magnet is levitating because gravity pulls it down, the repulsive force pulls it up, and there is a point of equilibrium, and this is where the small magnet floats. Well, but there is more. And what I explained to you so far is the Meissner effect. We have a superconducting disk, we cool it down, it expels a magnetic field. This creates a purely repulsive force and can make an object float. But what happens is, we have different types of superconductors. And the Meissner effect leads to a complete expulsion of magnetic field lines. But the superconductors which are technologically relevant for applications are type 2 superconductors. And they are not completely repelling the magnetic field. They allow some magnetic field to go through the superconductor in the form of flux quanta. And what happens is, these flux quanta can literally be pinned. They become rigid. And then you have sort of a frozen-in magnetic field configuration, which creates now not only a repulsive force. Once the flux is frozen in, the magnet and the superconductor become almost rigidly coupled. And this is different from what I've shown to you. It's a flux-pinning effect. And this is what I would like to demonstrate to you next. So, actually, for the experts, the superconductors I have here are YBCO, and what I've so far shown to you is with the Meissner effect is a polycrystalline form. They are both type 2, but I showed you first the polycrystalline form which has a very low critical current, and therefore the Meissner defect dominates. What I use now is a little bit more expensive piece of superconductor, which is now single domain, a single crystal. It has a high critical current, and this one will show the flux pinning effect, and this is what I want to demonstrate to you now. So let's take down our superconductor. And now I use, to make it more dramatic, a really strong magnet. And I want to make, since it's so strong, it's harder to control. So I put a spacer between the magnet and the superconductor. And now I cool it down. So what you see here is sandwich, piece of superconductor, something which is just a piece of plastic board as a spacer, and then the magnet on top of it. So now we take our sandwich and freeze it. So what do we expect now? The magnet has a magnetic flux, but if this flux is pinned, it's almost like the magnetic field lines will now attach the magnet to the superconductor like Velcro. And it won't be just the repulsive force, I will be able to turn it to the side and it's not falling down. It's completely pinned in space, it's stable in all three dimensions. And this is my third demonstration for you, eddy currents, Meissner effect, and now I want to show to you something which is qualitatively different, it's the flux pinning effect. This is a little bit thicker disk, so it takes a few extra moments. Getting there. So I took this spacer out, and this magnet is now levitating. It's hard to see, but it's now a sandwich, but the middle layer is missing. And I want to demonstrate it to you. I use this little magnet, and I take it out. I can even turn it to the side. You can look through, there is a gap between it. So it's magic. It is magnetic fields. Which are now attaching the two pieces to each other, and it's done by electrons which march in lockstep, but now they have pinned the magnetic flux. Okay, now I can relax because everything has worked. But I want to show you one more thing now, just for fun and entertainment. I use the same stack and cool it down. And what I want to show you now is what is called a magnetic bearing. You know how bearings work. Bearing means something rotates and you use ball bearings. But you use ball bearings because balls, little spheres, have very little friction. But what has even less friction is actually if you don't have any balls, if you just have an air gap. And I want to show you now a superconducting bearing. So we use the same situation, the same setup again. It is our sandwich, which we cool down. Then I take out a little bit more nitrogen. Let's get out our spacer, create the air gap. Ah. Okay. So now we have again this levitating situation, and now I take an object which is actually a fairly heavy, well, relatively heavy aluminum disc. I put it on top of it. So this is now levitated. So now I have a magnet, but the magnet is so strong, we can levitate not only the weight of the magnet, but we can put in full object on top of it. And now it can spin, and because there is no material friction, the magnet is now spinning, levitated on top of the superconductor. This is literally frictionless bearing based on the principles of superconductivity and flux pinning. Okay. Good. So what have we seen today? Persistent currents, phase transition to diamagnetic material, flux pinning. Flux pinning provides lateral forces and attractive forces. I've shown you the magnetic suspension effect and the magnetic bearing. Okay, now how are we doing about time? I wanted to sort of come back now. I've explained to you the coldness. I've explained to you what particles march in lockstep. I wanted to now come back to our research and show you 10 minutes about what is more recent research is. Okay. So let me now make the connection. I've shown you that when we cool down gases, they form a new material, similar, has properties like a laser beam, has properties like superconductors. But what that means is we have now a platform with these ultra-cold atoms at nano-Kelvin temperatures to create and study new materials. So in our current research, we are literally using these very, very cold atoms as Lego pieces. You know, at high temperature, the pieces just move around, but if you bring them to a standstill, we can now use laser beams and other tricks to assemble them to new and interesting materials. This is actually called a quantum simulator. We are simulating real materials using ultra-cold atoms. And let me make the connection, since you have the Institute for Quantum Computation here, that this is a special purpose quantum computer. So how we do that is the following. I've already told you that we have these ultra-cold atoms and they are in the middle of a vacuum chamber. But now we can, so to speak, assemble them, modify their properties and create new materials by adding, we cannot touch them, but we can add laser beams, microwaves, radio frequency fields, and with those electromagnetic fields, we are modifying the properties of those atoms that the Lego pieces behave in a new way. And let me illustrate that with something which you all know, namely crystals. I mean, nature has many, many materials are crystalline. And of course, who could not marvel at the beauty of a quartz crystal? But when we do fundamental research, we want to study crystalline objects in its simplest possible form. And this is just complicated with the many, many crystallites. But what we study is a much more regular lattice, which is a cubic lattice. So how do we make a cubic lattice of these atoms? Well, how do we create that? Well, we can only use laser light, but we can use it very efficiently. When two laser beams interfere, they form a standing wave. And a standing wave means that you have high electric field, no electric field, high electric field, no electric field. And now the atoms are attracted by the electric field as ion filings are attracted by magnetic field. So when you sprinkle cold atoms into the standing wave, the atoms will form a periodic pattern. That can be in one dimension, it can be in two dimension, or it can be in three dimension. So what the atoms experience in this two-dimensional standing wave is a modulated electric field which creates for them a potential exactly like an egg carton does for the eggs. And now we can put atoms into it, and with a microscope, we can observe individual atoms. And if we have a sparsely filled lattice, we see each dot is an atom, but we see they really align on the grid lines. But if, but you would say, well, why don't you just, you know, use eggs? Why do you, you know, go through all these expenses and use atoms? Well, with atoms, we can simulate what electrons do in matter. The eggs, they never move around unless you take them. But the atoms, even if they sit in the potential, they can go through the walls. This is quantum mechanical tunneling. What I want to show you here is a situation where people at Harvard had prepared, just in this egg carton, one line of atoms, and then they allow them by lowering the potential to sort of spread out. So they will now go through the walls and spread out. It looks now like random. But what happens quantum mechanically is the wave of the atoms has spread out, but now we detect the atom and we only see the atoms when we switch on the microscope and we see dot, dot, dot. But they are really just representative of one wave. And now I want to show you that those atoms behave as a wave. I want to show you a series of pictures where they spread out. They spread out. And almost magically, they come back. The reason is the atoms behave as one wave, and after a certain time, there is a special constructive interference where all the waves interfere in such a way that you have only atomic waves at the original position and nothing elsewhere. So what you see here can never be explained by a mechanical model. This really shows that what has spread out are waves, and the waves now come back through the process of constructive interference. Well, coming back to the analogy of eggs, there is of course something special when you have one egg per side, because then the egg carton is full. Now we can do that with atoms. If we have one atom per side and they repel each other, we have an insulator. But if the atoms do not repel each other, they tunnel, and actually sometimes we have two or three atoms per side. What I'm describing to you is, depending on the properties of the system, we can have a superfluid, a Bose-Einstein condensate, a conductor, or where transport is possible, or we can have something where things are completely frozen out in insulator. So we can now study that in the laboratory, and this is something very special. It's actually a phase transition. We talked about phase transitions when I cool down water, but this is a quantum phase transition, which even takes place at zero temperature. And if you think this is just a game of eggs, well, it's a quantum egg, and this is exactly where we make progress in science. By having such a simple system, which is complicated enough, and we can now, in combination with those experiments, learn how to fully describe and understand it. And I estimate that about 1,000 papers have been written just about this phase transition between those two situations. Finally, as sort of an appetizer or a teaser, let me talk about something which came out of my laboratory just a year ago. It was a new form of matter which has never existed before, a supersolid. And maybe the non-physicist I could tease by saying, this is actually something which is a gas, a liquid, and a solid all at the same time. So now you can go back and say, hey, what the high school teacher told me is wrong. Well, modern materials are much richer than the standard materials. And just maybe to demystify it, we have three dimensions. And it's really easy, almost trivial, to create a form of matter which forms like a gas in one dimension, a liquid in the other one, and which is rigid in the third one. But what was special about our research was that it was actually a supersolid. It combined in one system the property of superfluidity, this is sort of waves marching in lockstep, and solidity. And the reason why this is special is because you would usually think those two things are mutually exclusive. In a solid, particles are localized, and even if they are identical, they are distinguishable because they are in different positions. Whereas in a superfluid, you want the waves to merge. You want to have everything marching in lockstep. And the question is, can you have both at the same time? I'm not trying to explain it to you. I just show you a picture. A solid means something has shape, and we were creating a superfluid which spontaneously showed a stripe pattern, and this is the property of a solid. So anyway, we are still continuing to use cold atoms, and we find materials which have never existed in nature before. So that's my final slide. So I try to show you what happens at absolute zero. I try to introduce you to some low temperature phenomena. But in the end, the focus is here. We can look for new quantum mechanical effects for new quantum materials. And actually, the research I described to you is really embedded into a larger body of research on, you know, quantum materials, quantum technology. Some of the techniques we use to produce cold atoms are used for quantum computer. So a lot of quantum metrology, quantum devices, you hear the word quantum a lot, and at least I gave you sort of one perspective in one of the subfields of this bigger enterprise. So with that, I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, because we all are blown away at your remarkable demonstration. You really witnessed this phenomena. We actually celebrated this whole like last few years. So I'd like to turn to the opportunity to the audience. If you have any questions for Professor Ketterle, feel free to do so. Question?
So you had a rotating variance frictionless, right? So
yes.
And that forms on the principle of spin.
Yes. Okay, good question. When we have flux pinning, it should really pin it. But what happens is the magnetic fields which were actually pinned in a circular geometry. And so therefore it rotates. So what happens is if you have a magnet which is circular and it rotates, it doesn't really have to rotate the field lines. The magnetic field is not changing when the magnet rotates. So that's a special part of, if I had used a very irregular object, it would not rotate. But I kept the rotational degree of freedom through symmetry. That to measure the Boltzmann constant. Probably not. You know, we will see a revision of SI units very soon. The decision has been made, and Boltzmann constant in the future will actually be defined. So there is sort of a question, the Boltzmann constant is actually the constant which relates energy to temperature. But I can explain everything to you by not using the word Kelvin at all. I could just say the atoms have an energy of so and so many joule. So the Boltzmann constant is only kind of referring to the way how we define what temperature is. And so I have to think about it. This is really a more complicated question. What is really just defining what a Kelvin is, and what is really something you can independently measure? And there is a whole field of metrology where they do that. And people, and you sort of, usually when you measure something on one system, it cancels out, but I know that PTB in Germany has measured, carefully done measurement in gases in two different ways, and now based on what exactly they measured with their calibrated instrument, then they could pull out the Boltzmann constant. But in our measurement, we don't do it because we are not using It's really more complicated. Okay, you asked me what can micro and nano Kelvin temperatures bring to society and to mankind. I can give you two answers. One is based on metrology and atomic clocks, and the other is by insight into new materials. The first thing is that atomic clocks are based on very precisely measuring frequency inside atoms. And if you take atoms which are cooled, maybe not quite to Bose-Einstein condensation, but at least microkelvin temperature, you can look at them much more precisely. And using that has improved the precision of atomic clocks by factors of 10 or 100,000. So today we have much, much, much more atomic clocks because the atoms are cooled. And what can better atomic clocks provide to you? Well, atomic clocks are needed for communication. Atomic clocks are used for the global positioning system. But now, and this is a revolution, as of a few years ago, this is really the latest, atomic clocks are so accurate that an atomic clock, when you move it around, will slightly change its ticking because it senses through Einstein's general relativity, theory of relativity, minute changes in the gravitational field. So we are just a few years away where I think we compare an atomic clock in Europe and in the US and we can measure continental drifts with that. Precision metrology, precise measurements, but when you ask where do we need precise measurements, the GPS only works because every GPS satellite has an atomic clock on board. The second thing which is closer to my lecture is I sometimes would it say like this. We want to figure out what spectacular new materials exist in nature. New materials drive new technologies. And what I'm doing is I'm using very, very low temperature to simplify things. At low temperature, you can eliminate thermal motion. Physics is just simpler, clearer at low temperature. And I try to discover new materials at low temperature. And I showed you the supersolid, something new which has not existed before. Is that useful? Not directly, because nobody can use materials which only exist in vacuum chambers at nanokelvin temperature. But once you show and prove that a new material is possible, then we know the laws of nature are compatible with some, you know, special new material. And this will, in the future, inspire people to look for those materials, maybe at room temperature, and then build devices out of it. So it's it helps measurement, and this has immediate application, but it is also a discovery tool which enables new materials and new technology maybe in 30 years from now. So what I demonstrated to you was the following. I had a superconductor and I exposed the superconductor to magnetic fields. And we were able to observe properties of the superconductor by the way how the material dealt with the magnetic field. For instance, if I had the superconductor, my second demonstration, which I called the Meissner effect, I had a disk. It was not superconducting. I could put a magnet right on top of it. But when the material became superconducting, it could not tolerate that. It had to lift up the magnet because it wanted to expel all magnetic fields. So I used the exposure of superconductors to magnetic fields to show you that there are dramatic changes when superconductors become superconducting.
Yeah. And, but the cooling theory
No, I used an analogy, and actually, maybe with your question, I could summarize it. What I showed to you is when the cloud suddenly turned elliptical. This was the transition to superfluid atoms, superfluid Bose-Einstein condensates, atoms which march in lockstep. And I try to show you something analogous with electrons, but here the signature was not that you saw an elliptical shape, you saw that suddenly the magnet started to float. So both were a sudden, dramatic change in the behavior indicative of a phase transition. And for the electrons, I could use the magnetic force as an indicator, whereas for the atoms, we needed the camera and all that. No. The question is there a violation of the uncertainty principle when we measure the velocity of the atoms? No, I mean, we have actually done some careful measurement and confirmed that the uncertainty principle exactly applies to a Bose-Einstein condensate and such. So what happens is that we... Oh, so you're wondering if we let the atoms go, we take a shadow picture. The shadow picture is actually a position measurement, but then we want to pull out the velocity. Okay, ultimately our measurements of velocity are limited by the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, but the Heisenberg uncertainty principle for that situation is only giving us such a small uncertainty that for everything I showed you today, it doesn't matter. But if we do more careful measurements, we figure out that the velocity cannot be more precise than the uncertainty principle demands. Okay.